afternoon, young ladies and young gentlemen. Thanks to NLB, I have the privilege of addressing all of you here. In my early days, I was a Boy Scout, and one of the stories, one of the songs I learned was, "My eyes are dim, I cannot see, I have not brought my specs with me." I'm a bit better placed. Thank God I brought my specs with me. So at least now I can see who you are. The topic is basically how we have progressed in transport from the days of the earliest colonization in Singapore. As I think all of you are aware, Stamford Raffles came here and set up a British colony here. And when he came, he was part of the East India Company, which, and I think quite a number of the people who came with him would have been Indians, probably, most probably in all probability, dressed as I am here today. Nothing more than this. They didn't have trousers and all that in those days. Anyway, when Raffles landed here, you may be surprised to find that there was already a transport company in Singapore, an Indian company called Nadaraja Bus Service. Nada, in case you're not aware, is walk, and Raja is king, so walking bus service. So in those days, the only way of transporting yourself was by walking, and that was the bus thing. That was the only means of walking around. Today, you cannot imagine how things were almost 200 years ago. But you can be assured that except for a few people who had horses, I don't think there were even horses in Singapore in those days, the earliest form of transportation would have been palanquin. I think you might have seen in China and India both, the women especially couldn't walk and they would be put in a sort of a carried thing. I think all of you have seen that. You call it a palanquin in India also, and the those people who are well moneyed off, they wouldn't walk, they were all carried on the shoulders of people. You might have seen Cleopatra being carried around on that also. One can say that in the earliest days, the bullock carts were in fashion. There were plenty of bullocks here. Kandangarbao is actually where the cattle were stored. And if you are aware, Chinatown was called Guchiachui, where cattle came and drank water. I think that's the translation from Hokkien. And in those days, there was a cart on which the cattle would pull it along. And in my days, in school, we used to make fun of it. You know, we had 1 cent coins which were about this big. And somebody would say, "What, you think you're 1 cent like a bullock cart wheel?" Because the two wheels were their big wheels. So until about 1840, from about 1840, the main form of transportation would have been horse baggages and bullock carts. The roads, there were no such roads. It's all either stone or mud. And go along that, and of course, one thing, Singapore is quite small. There really wasn't much space to go around with, so these were enough for transportation. Coming on to from about a few years later, then just found out the rickshaw started coming into fashion here. The original name was jinrickshaw. I think it's a Japanese concoction, man-powered vehicle. And I think if you look at history, the earliest days, that was the main transportation apart from the bullock cart and the horse buggies. Have any of you seen the bullock carts around, the rickshaws around? pulled by, you know, they had a sort of thing on which somebody sat, usually one or two people, and was pulled along. Most of the rickshaw pullers came from the Fujian district. Mostly, if you know the dialects, they were either Hokchia or Hinghua. And although by the time I was quite small, there were still rickshaw pullers around, it was quite pitiable to see them pulling along people, you know, sometimes two, three, four people along there. What was worse was they were paid very small amounts of money for pulling along, 3 cents for half a mile and 6 cents for a mile. And they were supposed not to go for more than 2 or 3 miles at a stretch. And most of these people came here from because of poverty from China. And they were forced to pull people along all the roads. And it must have been crucial, I mean, excruciating work to go in the sun and the rain and pull people along. For them, the only way out was to get rid of the pain was opium. So all of them, most of the shopplers used to be thin, emaciated, and in pretty awful physical shape, but still they had to. Working life of the rickshaw pullers was usually from about 20 to 40, and few of them had money to buy their own rickshaws. They had to rent it, just like today. You have the taxi cabs all rented out. So in those days, rickshaws were also rented out. This was the original state of affairs until about 1882, when the first electric train was introduced in Singapore. Keppel Harbour was being built. And from Collyer Quay, I think you're all familiar with the Asia Building, from Collyer Quay to Keppel Harbour was the first stretch of land there. But the price of the fare was quite expensive. It's cheaper, and moreover, you had to walk. Only between those distances was the transport available. So for quite a number of years, for almost 70 to 80 years, the main form of transport was rickshaw. Cars hadn't come into fashion in those years, and even since the cost of maintaining and the income was not sufficient, those electric trolley trams, which were run on rails, dug into the ground, you know, just like you see the railway trains now. They had the wheels going through the ruts in the ground. Since it was expensive and not economic, after a couple of years, that died out. This was in the 80s, early 80s. In between, nothing happened until about 1905, when the electric trains were taken over by somebody else. Trams. Somewhere around that, when cars became available, buses started moving around. The traction company, these buses, these are actually trolley buses. And if, as you can see, in the earliest days of the trams, that was powered by coal, steam. From about 1925, these buses started coming into action. They were powered by trolley lines, the electric lines on the top, and they were fitted with pneumatic tires, rubber tires. So you had only certain stretches, because the buses had to be fitted. You could see the lines there on the top there, electric poles. And there's this pole connecting them. And the electricity to power the car, the trolley, used to come from the electric lines. There were only a few places where this was happening. One was from Chinatown down to Geylang. I think that's number two. There was one where I was staying in Newton, and the trolley buses used to be from Newton Circus, where the food center is now, until Collyer Quay, Asia Building. They used to go through Bukit Timah Road, Rochor Road, then on, turn into Victoria Street, go straight all the way down to High Street. From High Street, go through the Connaught Drive, and eventually ended up at Finlayson Green. Now, the thing was, since the electric lines were all straight, and the grooves had to go into, when he came to a corner, the conductor had to get out of the thing and move the pulley around to fit it again there. And I'm not very sure of this. I think there was no space for two buses to go. So when it came, they were going in opposite directions. The one which is coming had to stop, and they had to switch those poles over to go to the other side, so that this one could go through and the other one go through. So it is, by today's standards, quite primitive. Now, even into the 1960s, these were still running around. There was also one line going from Collier Quay all the way down to McPherson Road. And at each one, and when you went inside, at the end of each line, they had a bus station, bus stop, sort of a telephone booth where the man would check buses have come and gone. From Newton Circus till Tikka was 2 cents. And I used to come quite frequently to Bras Basah Road and the library, which used to be there, the museum now. 3 cents, I'd get down at the corner there and walk down to Bras Basah Road. Of course, in those days, even 1 cent meant a lot, you know. In the earlier days, even quarter cent and half cents were around. Today is no value at all. So when, you can switch on to the next one. These are the trolley buses that you can see. It was still, and the headquarters of the trolley bus was in Mackenzie Road. All the buses used to come, just as we have a bus depot now, all the buses used to come at Mackenzie Road. There was one entrance at Mackenzie Road, one entrance at Bukit Timah Road. The whole area was full, was where the buses came. All trolley buses. Singapore Traction, they were all run by the Singapore Traction Company, STC. STC, apart from these trolley buses, they also had normal buses as we do have today. I don't think I ever went into the normal buses, you know. I only went along with these trolley buses. So I'm quite familiar with those. And you get inside, there was the trolley bus used to have two sections. In the front, you go next to the driver, the small compartment of which about 4 to 6 people could sit, 3 and 3. Then there's a wide crossbar, and then all the way the rest of us were sitting there, wooden benches. And second class. So the first was first class. Few people went there except the moneyed people. Most of us sat in the second class. And tickets used to be, I think, come to the next one. These are tickets. Tickets were about the same. You know, the conductor had a clipboard. And he would, thank you. And you, he had a sort of punch. He'll come along, 2 cents, 2 cents. Then he'll click the two. One hole will go onto the first where you got on, and the next one for your 2 cents. How far you could go? You can see the holes there. So all this was still until the STC closed down in 1973. This practice was still going on. Traction Company had all the plumb routes within the city. Outside the city was left to the Chinese bus companies to run. And in the early days, soon after the First World War, there were small buses where about 7 people could sit, you know, 3 on one side, 3 on one side, and 1 in the center. They were called mosquito buses. Their fares were much cheaper. And they were small and very handy to go around. So now we're talking of transport in those early days. Not many people had cars, not many people could afford to have cars. So apart from walking, most people had to walk also. Buses were the cheapest and easiest way to go around. The conductors and the drivers who were actually very, very poorly paid. But they had to, because, you know, in fact, we're going back to the earlier days, the rickshaw pullers were all more or less clannish. If you come from a certain clan, the owner of the of rickshaws would let it out only to his own clan. So there are four or five different clans, mostly from the Phuchao district there. And coming from the same clan, speaking the same dialect, they were kept together more or less in the same, within the same, they were all put up in quarters, like more or less like cattle. So the bus companies, of course, there was also a certain amount of, you know, a lot of tribes and gangs going around. So basically, the workers had little say in the matter. They kept on, they couldn't afford to buy their own. They had to rent it daily, and there's an existence day to night almost. The traction company started out, it was a company started in England, 1925, and it proved fairly popular. But what happened was, it was a distant absentee landlordism, in the sense that nobody came from England to supervise it, so it's run here. The working conditions were pretty awful. Pay was small. But in those days, you know, everybody was, a lot of people were unemployed. And you simply had no way but to accept whatever job was there, with whatever drawbacks there were, you had to keep on going with that. 1938, they went on strike, the traction company. They said their wages were too low. I think you would have seen there. They were paid about $40 a month, and it was not even enough to keep them in body and soul together. So they went on strike in 1938, and for 140 days, there was a strike, which more or less paralyzed Singapore. Of course, in between, the other options have came up, that you could have a bicycle to go along. Anyway, the roads were pretty awful in those days. Tarring was going only in stages, and most of it cobbles, potholes, and all that. So in 1938, the employees of the Singapore Traction Company went on strike, and eventually the government, the British government, had to step down and set up a tribunal to decide on good working conditions for them. There were four people on that tribunal. Two were Europeans. There was one Chinese gentleman who was co-opted. And there was also one Indian, because a large number of the workers in the traction company were Indians. The Indian who was called in was my father. Can you see? You can see. See, as he says there, the working conditions were so awful that wasn't even, the salaries they got were not even enough to keep body and soul together. And there were no trade unions, there were no unions to talk of in those days. You just had to accept whatever was given to you, because you had no other way of working. So these are the four people who co-opted into that. And apparently they did a good job, because there was a letter of commendation from the governor. This is, I think, the only copy which is now with the archives. Each of the gentlemen there would have had it. Luckily, my father had kept it, and this is there. I donated it to the archives. So after that, conditions were a bit better, and Traction Company went on running. But unfortunately, it was riddled with corruption, because the company was registered in England, and the shareholders were everywhere, but the running was left in Singapore. So unfortunately, since the salaries were low, what would happen is, you go into the bus, and you say you want to go pay 15 cents for the ticket. The conductor will tell you, give me 10 cents enough, he gives you an old ticket. So it was going rampant until the company started running at loss, and conditions came from bad to worse. So after the war, it was running consistently at a loss, and the company shares, which were £1, came down to about almost 10% of that. In other words, almost bankrupt. So in the meantime, the Chinese buses also had started. They were operating on all the movies of the outside Singapore, the say from Changi to Capitol, and Capitol to Pasir Panjang, and even from Singapore to Johor, they were all run by the Chinese companies because the British company got the plum jobs, which is within the city. And when you talk of it, the green bus operated from Singapore, Rochor Road, to Johor, 60 cents. There was a, but it stopped at all the bus stops along the way and kept getting passengers. So in between, a Singlian Express came, which was non-stop. For that, we paid 80 cents from Rochor Road all the way down non-stop to Johor Bahru. These are in the olden days. And in the meantime, since the buses were operating, pirate taxis started cropping up. See, on the same routes that the buses were operating, if you had to pay 25 cents for going, say, from Seligi Road down to Aukang, the pirate taxi would take you for 30 cents, four people would sit inside, and those were all Mercedes. I had a very wealthy lawyer friend. I told him, why don't you buy a Mercedes? He said, no, if I buy a Mercedes, people will stop me thinking it's a pirate taxi. So these are the olden days. Rickshaws were eventually, because they were looked as being rather inhumane, they were phased out quite early. And after that came trishaw. That is, you know, we have a bicycle and the trishaw is attached to that. I think even today you have, as a tourist attraction, the thing coming around here in Bencoolen Street, they have it. I'm not sure whether they have it or not. In Singapore, they have it by the side. In Penang, the passenger sits in the front. Anyway, these are the old modes of transportation. 1954, from the 1950s, unionism started to become rampant in Singapore. And all the bus companies had their own unions. 1954, there were two rival unions, which prompted a fight between them, and there was another, what is called the Hockley riots. You can read up on that anywhere in the archives. So when you come to 1973, the Singapore Traction Company found it was unable to carry on. It went bust. Then the Singapore government brought all the other companies together and formed what is running today, SBS, Singapore Bus Transport. That's been running from 1974. I think most of you are quite familiar with the later SMRT and all that. There's quite, you can find out, you can, it's quite easy to go through that. But those of you who are interested, if you really want to know how awful conditions were for those rickshaw pullers, if you Google and just go and put their rickshaws in Singapore, there's a fascinating book on conditions and how those people who came there were treated. You know, it makes really heart-rending to see how they suffered in those days. Those of you who are interested, you'll find it really worth reading. Now we have come today. You have come to expect transport as easy, but when you look at it now, you have more people, and you still find crowds. The same thing happened in those days. Only thing, and I sometimes wonder, it takes you about as much time with all the facilities. In the early days, I could go from Newton to Johor Bahru in 30 minutes. Today, and in those days, the car couldn't go at more than 40 kilometers per hour, 40 or 45. Today, it takes you about the same, and you can go at 80 miles per hour, 80, 100 kilometers per hour. So sometimes you wonder whether how far we have advanced. But of course, one thing, we are more comfortable, and you can go faster, and there are more transport facilities around here. So basically, we've come far, quite far from walking. And you can walk out of your place almost from point A to point B. You don't have to walk at all nowadays. Why did trolley buses disappear from the streets of Singapore? I think we can answer that in just two words. One, progress, and the other, wireless. You see, in those days, you needed wires, as you saw in that trolley bus there. And today, everything is wireless. Previously, you needed a telephone. Now you walk around everything. You don't need a wire for anything at all. So I think in two words, you can answer why they were phased out. Tram was on rails, embedded in the ground. You see, they had, I think, even into the 50s, the tram lines were there. See, the tram lines hadn't been taken out. They were like rails, you know, you were there. And they had grooves going along that. I've seen they were taken out later there. Trolley buses didn't need the in-grooved one. They went along on the cables, on the overhead cables. You see, the trolley buses were only along selected routes. They were not all over Singapore. As I said, from Newton to Collyer Quay was the focal point, being the hub of the city.